And now, before I turn this over to Dr. McCarthy to begin this conversation with Ms. Paulus, I'm thrilled to open this evening with a musical tribute to her. I'd like to now introduce performers from Thayer's upper and middle schools, Duxbury High School, Holbrook Middle and High School, the Inley School, and Silver Lake Regional High School, under the direction of our theater director, Kelly Hines. Welcome and enjoy.
Felt alone, I'd look towards the night sky, and a star I call my own,
somewhere I could run to, just across the Milky Way. If you like, I could take you.
Navigate the then it's white. And when it is dark, then it's light. So fill in all the spaces with imaginary places.
It's so frustrating when no one else sees everything you see. So for now it is just an illusion, confusion, unless you're someone who believes. When you look, tell me, what do you see? Is it real?
Recommend biting off more than you can chew to anyone. I do. I recommend sticking your food in your mouth at any time. Feel free.
Throw it down. The caution blocks you from the wind.
Thank you.
work in the theater, and if you have, you know, the journey of your life to get to Broadway, which somehow my life has been, and I was at high school doing high school musicals and went to college. I remember I was at Harvard as an undergrad, and it was June. For some reason, I was still on campus in June, and I was in the basement of one of the houses doing my laundry. And the Tony Awards were on in like the basement. They had a TV, and I remember just sitting there with like my laundry basket. I'm like, oh, maybe one day, like maybe it will happen. You know, you never know where your life will take you. But for me, the whole journey to being on Broadway has been so much about this extended community of theater. And I always think about this connection. That what I do on a place like Broadway is absolutely connected to what you just did on the stage. So I just want to say, you know, that really, really meant so much. And of course, I was like, all those songwriters, like, I'm going to call Gary Barlow after this, I'm going to call Alanis, I'm going to call Sarah Bareilles, I'm going to tell them all that I was at this high school in Braintree and the songs were done this way. Amazing arrangements, by the way, to your musical director. Well yeah. done. And I don't know, the singer who did Magic to Do, where are you? I mean, that you had the moves. You did this, you had all the moves. I was like, she must have seen the production. So you were definitely channeling a little Patina Miller there. Like, oh, you had all the gestures on the lyrics. It was amazing. So
I did not realize how moved I was going to be by that. I kept that secret from her for months. I said, there's going to be something first, and it's a secret, and you're going to love it. That's all I said. And then when we got there, she's like, are we standing? And I said, you didn't rehearse the dance number?
Yeah.
So anyway, Diane, what you just did and what you all just did and that connection is why we wanted to invite you here to be in this space with all of us, because you are such a light, and what you just expressed is like at the core of who you are and why I love you so much as a human, not just an artist and a leader. So, whew, God, now we're going to get into our conversation. It's great to be with you. Second night in a row. We've been together two nights in a row. This is a special week, a treat. And maybe if you could just sort of pick up where you left off with the sort of origin story, sort of like how you came up and like what got you to doing what you're doing with your life. Like, what were those moments that shaped you and that propelled you to want to commit your life to this beautiful work?
Yes, I mean, we could be here all night. I'm gonna try to do it quickly. I grew up in New York City, and I had a family who really believed in the arts. My father had been an actor early in his life, and then went on to producing theater. He was actually a soldier in the American occupation of Japan. He went overseas, and because he had been an actor, what did he do for the United States Army in Tokyo? He directed plays for the Army Entertainment Corps there. And it wasn't until much later in life that I discovered an old newspaper. It was a Stars and Stripes newspaper, and in it, lo and behold, was a picture of my father. And it was like, Larry Paulus pulling his hair out because the show must go on tonight, you know. And I looked at it, and it's this funny thing where I was like, no wonder I do what I do. You know, you go on these journeys, and you have all this input in your life, whether it's from parents or mentors or amazing high school teachers, and they stay with you. And so I think, you know, definitely my parents were a huge influence. My mother loved the opera. She was Japanese. She met my father met her in Tokyo during the occupation. They had an illicit love affair. It was against army rules. She eventually came to the United States. They got married. But she loved the opera. Her family was very theatrical and musical. So that was a part of my life. And I was taken to see theater all the time. And I don't know, my father would make me read articles out loud from the New York Times when I was a kid, and he would coach me on my enunciation. It was just, and I was sort of the performer. I was one of three children, and my brother and sister would just, you know, rather like disappear than do what my father would ask them to do. But I was like the performer. I wanted to always perform and do things. So I loved acting and performing. I studied music, which I was really grateful for. I played the piano for 15 years, and I think I might have gone into music if I played a different instrument, but the piano was a very solo thing, and I remember my piano teacher saying, you know, if you want to take this seriously, it's like 4 hours of practicing a day, and maybe we'll get you into the pre-college program at Juilliard, and I had this moment, which I think we have to do in life. I was in touch enough that I thought, like, I don't want to be by myself. You know, I liked being with people. I liked being in a group. And so I was part of a children's theater group. I had done some dance as a young child, a New York City ballet. So I'd been exposed to art and theater. And I loved the group process. I just felt myself most alive. And I think it's what I continue to love in the theater, because when you're part of a group, and I loved your opening speech about, you know, what it means to be in community here. You know, what is it to be in a group? How do we put away our own ego and become part of something larger than ourselves? And I think I craved that. I craved it on a really big way. I was fascinated with the 1960s. I thought I missed my decade. You know, I just wanted to be part of that. You know, all the stuff that you know, I read about, that sort of, you know, countercultural movement and all the theater that happened there. And of course, then when I got to direct Hair, it was my opportunity to live that and put that on stage. But anyway, flash forward, I did a lot of theater as a kid. I did it in high school, but then I went to college. I went to Harvard, and I thought I was going to go into politics. I was very passionate about the world I was living in. Like, growing up in New York in the 70s, I just believed it could be a better place. I marched for nuclear disarmament, for the ERA movement. I went to Albany, and I was part of a campaign, you know, as a high school student for Planned Parenthood. So I did all these, you know, sort of politically active things, but then I had always done theater. And I think it was, I spent my summer after my freshman year as an intern for Ruth Messenger, who was a very famous councilwoman for the Upper West Side in Manhattan. And, you know, they were sending me out to all these meetings, and they said, go to City Hall, and I was doing all these political things. But I really looked in my heart, and I thought, you know, I could do all this. I was a very disciplined person, but, like, I missed doing theater. It was something about, you know, politics was like one step removed, and I really, you know, I mean, you know, politics is theater too, we know that, but I just felt there was something about the making of theater that felt, I guess the angle I got from Ruth was like, yeah, you're going to go to that meeting, and you're going to tell the Coalition for the Homeless that you support what they're doing, and I went to that meeting, and I was more interested in how they were talking about the van routes and how they were gonna get food out to the homeless. Like, I wanna be in the van, I wanna be with the people, I wanna be part of that production. So I went back to college, and I threw myself more and more into theater. I found a way to write my senior thesis. I was a social studies major, but I wrote it about the Living Theater, which was a political theater group in the 1960s. I just kept finding ways to bring theater into what I was doing academically, and I then spent all my summers doing theater. I went to the Williamstown Theater Festival. I was an apprentice. You know, I was absorbing, and then I always tell, like, college students this, because it's that pressure of, like, what are you gonna do when you, I was like, I had a car, my brother had a car, he gave it to me, I graduated Harvard, I was gonna drive across America. Like, that's what I was gonna do with my now husband. You know, we were gonna go to the Yukon and see America and, like, get real. And, like, the car broke down on Linnaeus Street, had to be towed. I had no idea. I was like, okay, now what? And I went and I auditioned for this acting program, which I got into, which led to another acting program. I ended up studying with the great Mike Nichols, very famous film director, Paul Sills, amazing guru of the improvisational theater. His mother was Viola Spolin, who wrote Improvisation for the Theater, which is like a Bible of theater games. So I got exposed to these amazing teachers. Mm. Started my first theater company, went to Door County, Wisconsin, where Paul Sills had a farm, raised money, took 16 actors out there. I was acting and directing and everything, and did that for 5 years. I mean, I grew up in Manhattan. I was, like, living in Door County, Wisconsin. And then there was someone in the community who came and said, okay, I'll wrap it up because it's getting long.
No.
He said to my husband and myself, we were just, you know, boyfriend and girlfriend, I was like, we want to buy you at an abandoned cheese factory. And they took us on a tour to this cheese factory in this little town south of Sturgeon Bay. And it was this amazing villa. We'll buy this for you. You can have an international theater center here. And I remember it was so youthful. Randy and I went on our bikes, you know, to like the lake, and we're like, should we do this? Like we were, I don't know, how old were we? Maybe 20, 24 or something, 25. And it was really this heart-to-heart moment. Like we could move here, we could make a life. I guess we could like buy a house in Sturgeon Bay and live here. And I think my you know, I was from New York, and I just thought, you know, I just want to go home and do what I did here in New York. I said it because we did a lot of work in community. I went door to door to all the restaurants and hotels and raised money, and we did shows with the local bar band. I mean, all the things I do now, my first life, I tested out in Wisconsin. You know, I got a local bar band to do a rock musical version of The Tempest because I thought that's how I'm going to get people to go to the theater, because if the local bar band is doing the musical, people will come. And then the guys in the bar band were like, we don't have time, it's the summer. I was like, don't worry.
It's Shakespeare.
I was like, we're going to rehearse at your early sets in the bar. Like, I found a way. And so we would go at like the 8 o'clock set in all these little bars all over Door County, you know, Fish Creek. No one was sitting there in the bar at 8 o'clock, and we rehearsed the songs from the musical. Lo and behold, the songs became the local summer hits. And it was such an interesting, I'm thinking of Mike Sheehan, my dear friend, interesting. It was like a marketing, like, you know, petri dish, because it was like, wow, the songs became the hits, the songs were on the local radio. All of a sudden, everybody wanted to see this musical from these kids. They didn't know who we were from New York, because it had meaning, right? Local meaning, and the local band was, you know, writing music for the show. So anyway, I did this experiment. I then finally said, I looked in my heart and I said, I'm directing now mostly, and I don't have enough tools. So I applied to graduate school, went to Columbia University, got my degree as a director, and then went back in the trenches. The first show I directed out of grad school was The Donkey Show, which some people may have seen. It came here and played here for 12 years. And how did I do that? In the lobby of the Columbia University Arts Building. Like, because the IRID still swiped, so we could get in for free. We rehearsed it late at night. And then I did that with a bunch of actors that were in my program there. With my now husband Randy, and you know, we did it for no money for months downtown in this little hole in the wall in the East Village at midnight, you know, every Friday and Saturday night at midnight. And it eventually hit. It like, and we also did a viral marketing strategy then too, where we said, you know what, we need people to see this. So we said, if you come to see the show, you can be a VIP. And we made this, it was early days of the internet. It was like, you can be a VIP. So we had a VIP list. He said, you can come back for free if you bring a friend. And then it like started happening over like 3 months. Next thing we knew, there were like 100 people lined out outside. And this is like downtown experimental theater when like 6 people come to your show. And you know, it's like your parents. So then it was, you know, 100 people down there. It was like, how did all these people hear about it? And it was the VIPs. It was like the VIPs had come. So I say all that to say, it was in the trenches. It was born out of passion. It was experimental. It was with my friends. It was like with no agenda. I was like, you know, thank goodness my parents slept in my, you know, childhood bedroom for free. My now husband, he's coming up a lot tonight. He also stayed there. Like my parents were very, they like let Randy stay there too. I mean, we were just, you know, whatever you could do. And eventually things started to happen and people started to come. It's like 3 months into the run of the show, The Donkey Show, we were having, you know, the head of a Broadway show there, and then a head of the Brooklyn Academy of Music, and the next thing you know, we were moved off Broadway, and these things happen. So it just goes to say, there's no, especially in the theater, I say to all young people, it's, you know, there are paths that you can take, right, to become a doctor. You have to go to medical school, you have to, you know, and it's not a direct path. And what I also say is, you know, because if I flash forward in my life, and you know, I had kids, and my career took off when I had my children. You know, like you never know. You have to just keep. What I love about being in the theater is, if you love it enough, you just keep feeding yourself, You feed yourself with ideas, with books, with inspiration, with the world. You see a lot of theater. And I think the longest, I'm going to now finish answering your first question. The reason why I did this, and I will say this, when I was at Harvard, you know, I pulled a lot of all-nighters to like hand in papers. And I thought, ugh, it was always a drag. I just remember like buying the M&Ms and like coffee. Like I would stay up all night to finish this paper. The theater, I would stay up all night. Mm. I didn't care. It's like rehearse all night to make the play. And I did say, you know, what is the thing that just I love? And I realized the theater, I loved it because it was intellectually stimulating. It was emotionally fulfilling. Mm. It was spiritually interesting. It was physically like challenging. It was all these things. Why wouldn't I do that with my life? You know, why wouldn't I do that? Like you and I knew enough that to be like a success in the world, you have to work hard. So why not work hard for something that you really love? And I think I had a family that, you know, wasn't pushing me to be a lawyer, even though I thought I had to be a lawyer. You know. Mm-hmm. But then, I used all those justifications. Well, like, I'll go to acting school because if I eventually become a lawyer, acting will help me. You know, you have all those justifications when you're young. But then opportunities came, I eventually found a way, to earn a living little by little. And then luckily, 15 years ago, I was pretty scrappy, still running around doing jobs. And eventually, I had gotten some bigger jobs and got this call to put my hat in the ring for the ART. And again, at that time, I was like, well, I don't know how to be an artistic director. I've, you know, done all these things, but I've never run a regional theater before. And it was a friend who said, why wouldn't you do that? Yeah. Why wouldn't you do that? Why go? You could change the American theater. I was like, okay, maybe I could. And, you know, I've been here now 15 years.
Yeah, I love it. Thank God for that. It's so funny. So one time, someone said, what's Diane Paulus like? And I said, if she were a drink, it would be a triple espresso. You just wind her up and you're off to the races and you're like that in so many different dimensions. And I love that. And I learned so much about you in that. You and I have been friends for a long time and I love all the little nuggets, the cheese factory. Like, I worked on one of Ruth Messenger's campaigns when I was a graduate student.
Wow.
Like, we probably...
Gail Brewer.
Yes, of course. Oh, my God. And now I'm having this moment, like, you wanted to go into politics. I also wanted to go into politics, and we found our way out of that. But now I'm having a vision, which is going to stay with me the whole drive back to Provincetown tonight, of you and I in the House of Representatives.
Yes.
Just mixing up with all those
crazy things. We would have found each other.
So I wanted, I have a bunch of questions, and they're sort of, you know, all over the place. But I want to start, you're known for many things. But two genres that you're very connected to are the musical, mm-hmm. right, and the revival, right? And Hair, obviously, being a spectacular example of that, but there are so many others. So if you could talk just a little bit about why the musical is something that, I hear it in that story, but the musical is a special type of theater, and then the revival is also its own thing. Like, why are you drawn to the musical, right? What is it about that that is something that you love, a particular love for? And then the revival, like, how do you choose when to bring something back, like Hair, or 1776, or any of the others that you
love? Yes, I love this question. So I love musicals for many reasons. One is they are deeply collaborative. I mean, all of theater is, but the musical is collaboration, you know, like escalated, because you just have so many things that are contributing to tell your story. It's not just the playwright, it's the music, it's the musical arrangement, it's the choreographer, and yes, it's the, you know, the set design, costumes, lights that you have in plays, but they're also playing with the music, right? And there's so many choices, and I think what I said earlier, I love that group endeavor. So the joy of being in a musical, and I mean this as a director, and I think this is something about leadership too. You know, you think like you're a director, you have to have all the ideas, and I think the opposite. You know, so many people come to me and say, oh, you're such an auteur. I was like, no, I don't have any idea. Like, I follow my instinct, I sense potential, and then I get the people in the room I want to be with.
Right, people who will go on the journey with me. And then I ask some questions, and then it happens. And then it's just like the thing starts to happen. And that's the process that, you know, I'm addicted to. It's just that thinking together, that group brain trust. There is nothing like a musical, you know. There's nothing like it. That it is a group. It is a group phenomenon. So I love that. I also love it because I believe musicals have meaning, to come back to this moment of being here at Thayer. You know, I'm very interested in the theater, not as an elite pastime, not as something that's kind of art with a capital A that just feels like it's like the city on the hill. And I really think, I love that you all sang those songs, because I think about sports a lot. You know, I think we love sports and we'll be very passionate fans because we've touched a football maybe, you know, in the yard on Thanksgiving. Like we go outside and throw a football around, or maybe we played it, you know. So I love, you know, musicals are the vernacular that most high schools touch. You know, you may not do all sort of like very, you know, a brand new play that's never made it into the high school kind of repertoire, but like most high schools do a musical. So I love musicals because I just feel like they're in our DNA. They're part of our, you know, kind of sort of like vertical society in a way, so that it's an entry point for audience, you know, for young people. And that I love musicals because you, the audience, are there. And when I think about the theater that really excites me, I love the moment of the audience. You know, I'm very interested in the moment of the audience being present, because to me, that is really theater. So what do I mean by that? You go to a musical and someone sings and we applaud, right? We're involved in a story, but we're going to simultaneously say, "That was amazing!" And we're going to applaud because, like, we want to say something back to the stage. We want to say, "I heard you. I see you. That was incredible." And it's usually doubled by the narrative, right? So sometimes, like, you're really applauding because it's the story that's moving you. But the musical leaves space for the audience to say, "I'm here." And I think we need those moments, right? And you know, for me in the theater, if I'm invisible or I'm not there, you know, maybe it could be a movie. Or it could be a great TV show when you're sitting, you know, why not just sit at home and, you know, be able to, like, pause it to go, you know, finish your dinner or finish your emails and then come back and click it back on. But there's something about the theater that requires this group attention. And you know, I see how doing musicals, like, actors are influenced by the audience. You know, and I like it. I like it when the audience is present. I like it when people sing out loud along with lyrics. Not all audience members like that. They're always like, "Can you get the ushers to tell them to stop singing?" I'm delighted. I was at a performance of Waitress. Does everybody sort of know? Maybe Waitress is a good one to talk about. So I was at this performance of Waitress. I went to sit in the balcony because I was like, I got to go up. It was like previews, opening Broadway. I said, I got to go upstairs and watch the show from the balcony. So I was there with my assistant. And there were these, the couple in front of me, and it's the moment where, you know, the doctor and Jenna's end of act one, and she's come early for the appointment, and the doctor's like tongue-tied, and she's like, "Well, is there something else you want to say to me?" And, you know, I directed Drew, he takes a pause, and he's like, about to say, and then he eventually says, "No, you can go now if you have any questions or concerns." But he's in that dramatic pause where he's going, and this guy in front of me screams out loud, "Say it!" Like, loud, from the balcony. And of course, I was like, oh my God, I was so excited. And then his wife was like, oh, she was so embarrassed. She was smacking him and, like, so embarrassed. And then that's, you know, they went on and the intermission hit, you know, and I could, she was like, "How could you do that? How could you embarrass me?" You know, like, don't behave that way. And, you know, I was like listening. And then when the show ended, I couldn't help myself. I'm like, "I'm so sorry. I'm the director." You know, I was so happy that you said that. That's like what I live for in the theater, when someone feels so passionate, like at a sports game, right? He would like call out. And then he stood up and, you know, his wife was so excited that I was the director. And then he turned and he was like, "Thank you." Like, I like saved him from like, you know, like from not having to go home and be like really in the doghouse for the rest of the night. Anyway, that was a long story, but I just love those moments. Right. Like when an audience, you know, I live for those moments. So anyway.
Meanwhile, that woman hates Diane Paulus.
True. I think she forgot. You know,
she's a little director of Waitress. Yeah. And I love it. I love it. And how about revivals?
Oh, revivals, yeah. Revivals are interesting, right? Because I always love the word revival. Yeah. Like, when we do a production of Hamlet, we don't call it a revival. It's just a production, right? We don't say we're reviving Hamlet. So it's a funny thing, this idea of reviving a musical.
But it's a category.
It's a category. But you know, I really look at the American canon of musicals as they're classics of their own nature. And so, I love to do revivals because, similarly, what we're speaking about larger cultural significance. You're not only creating something new, but you're dealing with cultural memory. So I don't know how many people here, like, had a memory of Pippin when you heard these songs. Are there people here who, like, either remembered those songs or, So for me, even me with Pippin, right, I'm so much older than all of you, but I sang it. I danced to the Manson Trio in my high school talent show, right? I sang the song With You, my days are brighter than morning air, da-da-da-da. If I could spend all my days with you, I sang that at my sister's wedding. I had no idea that was a song in Pippin, where Pippin is like going woman to woman to woman. Like I didn't even know that that was the context
of
perfect wedding song. I played Corner of the Sky on the piano. So what does that mean? These songs mean something to you, right? So I'm interested in a revival because you're tapping into something larger. That has a larger significance and has a kind of meaning beyond the theater. Yeah. So even Jagged Little Pill, frankly, which was not a revival, I put in that category because we're in a way bringing that album back out of the 90s and dealing with people's kind of cultural, emotional, social memory.
Yeah.
You hear that song, you live, you learn, like, and you could go to a memory like when I heard that song.
Yeah.
But now I'm hearing the lyrics in a new way, I'm seeing a new story, so I'm interested in those multiple layers of meaning. And I also love revivals, by the way, because I love theater history. You get to look; it's another layer of information. So you go back and you can study what a revival, what a show meant in its original time, and then you bring it. You can try to. What I try to do is not recreate that the museum, but do that for an audience now. So I've done a lot of opera too. I'll give you an example. Like when I first time I did Marriage of Figaro by the Mozart di Ponte opera, I was studying the history of Marriage of Figaro. So in the premiere of Marriage of Figaro, there's like, people are standing to see the show. Like two people die because they get squished because there's a crowd effect. Like what we read about the horror of like soccer games where things get out of control. Like, and then there were 8 encores because the audience was so, no recorded music. They heard that aria and they just clapped so long they had to do it again. And they clapped again. There was like 8 times they repeated one aria to the point that Joseph II afterwards banned encores. Like, didn't want to have to sit through such a long thing. So I look at that and I'm like, okay. Mozart and Ponte are like the rock stars of their time, and we think of opera and we think it has to be polite and feel a certain way, and that gives me inspiration. How am I going to direct Marriage of Figaro to make an audience feel like this is vital? They're like the bad boys of their time, critiquing society, starting the French Revolution with their politics of like making the servant characters do something big, So I get interested in studying the historical setting so that I can then say, what does that mean for Tony? How can I recreate what the authors originally intended, but for the moment we're in?
Mm.
So it's just more information.
Yeah. So I'm going to get back to that in a second, but I wanted you to take us into the rehearsal room with Diane Paulus, director Paulus. I remember the first time you invited me into rehearsal, one of the things I also want to just amplify about something you said is that you are constantly seeking information, reactions, insights, analysis, criticisms from people. Like the number of times you've said to me, give me notes, send me your notes, right? And you do that with everybody. I'm not special. You do that with so many
people.
You're
special.
But you do that all the time. Like, I want to hear what you're saying when you see this at whatever stage it's in development, But I remember thinking, you know, I'd gotten to know you, we're friends, and then I went into rehearsal. I think it was for Witness to God. I think it was when it was going to New York to become Invisible Threat. And I went in for the first time. This was like mid-2010s, right? And I was like, oh, this is a whole other side of Diane Paulus that I've seen, meticulous and fierce and focused and all these things. And so take us into, like, what's your style as a director? Like, what do you feel are some of the kind of signature aspects of how you approach directing these communities that you create and you're a part of?
I love being a director because you are in charge of creating the conditions for people to be the best they can be. So that gives a lot of joy, you know, and I'm sure every teacher here in the room can relate to that, and every parent, frankly, you know, it's that joy, and you know, you always say an actor's working well when, like, you don't recognize them anymore, you know, when they just transform. So what can I do in a room to encourage everyone to go beyond what they think they can do? How can I take a risk? How can I? And you know, that goes in many different ways. So, you know, having talked about, you know, what it is to be a leader, there's no one formula. Like, I know enough now that some actors need to be really carefully encouraged, go slow. Others need, like, tough love. Others I'm not even gonna talk to, because they need a couple days, you know. I just gonna let them make their mess over there, and then I'll come in at the right moment, and it might not be in the rehearsal hall. It's gonna be outside by the water fountain, you know. So you're looking at how do you, you know. And then I also love directing because you've got to make a group happen, and so I think, you know, anyone, you know, who's involved in running a company or running a sports team, you know, there is that joy of like a group doing something that only a group can do. And I do start every rehearsal by saying, I'm gonna bring ideas, and I look at everyone in the room, including the actors, because a lot of time actors think like, oh, just tell me what to do, Diane. I'll do anything you want. I'm like, no, actually, you know, I want you to come with ideas. So I you have to reset that, right? Because we tend to think in hierarchies, right? We tend to think, even in school, right? I'm the student, I'm gonna be told what's right or wrong. So you have to actually reset the rules. So I say, I'm gonna come with ideas, I hope you will come with ideas, I hope you'll come with lots of ideas, but guess what? Together, we're gonna find a third idea that is better than either of ideas, right? And if you set the table like that, I think it makes everybody feel creative and not like, what's the right thing to do? And the more I, as a director, can, you know, say, look, I'm gonna be very clear. You can't not have an idea, right? I work very hard to prepare. Your job as a director is to do all your research, all your work. You have to know more than anybody so that you can be as passionate and educated. But if you do all that work, then you can come in the room and you can say to a group of people, here's what I know and here's what I don't know. And this is the challenge for today. How are we gonna make that work? And then you just see everybody just starts to tune in a different way. And it's thrilling to see that happen. You know, so I think those are the conditions I like to make. I'm very physical, so I usually stand up a lot. You know, I don't like to sit behind a table. I have like a music stand when I direct, and I like to be physical because I've been a performer. I do expect everyone in the room to be a contributor. So, you know, if someone's in the room, it's like, don't be on your phone, you know, don't be reading a book. Like, you can go outside and read a book, but if you're in the room, there's an attention to what's going on that has to be there.
Yeah.
And I think we crave those environments. We're multitasking way too much in life, and I'm the biggest, you know, like, you know, I do that myself. So what I love about directing is it's like being present. And I think we all are craving those moments of being present. So I know directing kind of saves me. I think about meditating a lot, but I haven't really gotten around to putting it into my life. But I read a lot about it, and I do some like 2-minute mindful things. But I know I should meditate. But I do believe when I go in rehearsal, it's like I actually have to just be present. I can't be in memory of yesterday and what the actor did yesterday or what I want. I actually have to see what's happening in front of me. And then I have to see it, and I have to, you know, the kind of Zen Buddhist saying of like, can you see without desire? Because as a director, you can really see with desire, like, I want them to do it that way, I wish you would do it that way, but like, can I see without desire to really see what's coming? And then feedback and change and question and do it again and practice and rehearse. And so it's like creating that environment where all of that is possible. Mm. I think we're going to get to questions in a minute.
Yeah, I always say to my students, when you're here, be here. You've chosen to take this class, right? You've chosen to be here. Let's all be here, including us, right? Yeah. The people who are in charge, right? I wanted to ask you a question about bringing together the kind of revival of the rehearsal room and the challenges of creating that. One of the things that I will always be indebted to you for is inviting me and a team of historians and scholars to be part of the 1776 revival. And that was a beautiful to be part of that, to see that show. But that was long in the making because as you were set to start rehearsal, the pandemic hit. And the timing of that revival was set to the election cycle. And that was one of the contexts, right? It was the 2020 election, which was quite a time. And so you had to pivot and create a rehearsal room on Zoom, which was unprecedented. Right, we all had to do it in various ways, but and I was part of those early rehearsals, and one of the first time we came in, you had this brilliant idea, which is still one of my favorite memories in my life, which was to read the Declaration of Independence, both the original draft that Jefferson penned, and the one that we now know, which of course has the erasures, which of course is the subject and plot of 1776. And most of those actors, right, and it was a very diverse, very gender-bendy cast, had never read the Declaration and didn't know there was a draft, right, many of them. And so what about that? There was a lot going on there, right? You had to pivot in a pandemic. You had to keep this community that was just starting to come together. You had no idea when the show was actually going to go on.
Yeah.
And you were trying to use history to do that.
Yeah.
Like, that was a... That was a remarkable set of convergences in that moment. So talk about like those kind of moments, because you do bring and invite those collaborations too, which I think is something that's quite uncommon and maybe even unique to you.
Yeah, I mean, look, that was right one of the hardest times for the theater, for all of us. But I remember I'd never been on a Zoom. I mean, hard to imagine that now when it's like Zooms every day, but I had never been on a Zoom. Right. And it was like, we had all these actors signed up and we had to cancel everything. I said, well, let's, they're all over the country because no one could travel. And we said, let's just maybe begin on this thing called Zoom if someone could show me how to do it. And we did it. And in a weird way, like life happens. It was like, well, all these professors, you being one of them and many others at Harvard, it was kind of a scheduling thing. Like, how are they gonna get to New York? How are we gonna get them there? And all of a sudden, everybody was available.
We were all in their living rooms.
Everybody could Zoom in. So it was this odd thing that life gives us, you know, when we get thrown the curveballs, like how do you make something work out of the worst possible situation? And we did. And you were so generous, and I remember that. We read it out loud, and it was scary and terrifying. We had never met. I mean, I had auditioned these people, but since then, we had never been in a room together. And for 2 weeks, we stayed on Zoom. And we did things like that exercise.
Talked about slavery and freedom.
Yeah, we talked about American history. And then while we were vamping, like, is what's happening? What's happening? And no one knew. And then, of course, it was like, are we going to delay the show? Maybe we'll be back in a month. Maybe we'll be back in 6 months. And then, oh, my goodness, 2 years. It was 2 years that we had to wait to do that show. Remarkable that almost all of them were in the production 2 years later. I mean, there were a couple that had other life events that took them in different directions. But that was a show I knew that I wanted to do that revival because I knew it could teach us about American history, and theater could be a vehicle for us to think about American history. Because I had never read 1776, and when I read it, I didn't know that there was a whole clause that Thomas Jefferson had put in the original draft that was against the, you know, equitable, you know, commerce of slavery, that it had been crossed out, and that there had been a debate about this. So I was personally interrogating my history. Like, why didn't I learn this in high school? Why do I think, even in my American history education, that like the Civil War is the slavery war, and that revolution was all Revere and the British, and not about that topic. And then, of course, here is this original. I remember I coming to you, and I think you said, "Oh yeah, the original sin." It's like, "Oh yeah, that's what it's called, swept under the rug." You know, so. Again, it goes back to the theme of I love to be in the theater because with every project, I get to learn. And I think when I think about what we do at ART, what we do, responsibly as a theater attached to Harvard University, how do we make theater a place of continued learning, right? And so, not about, end goals or, I was in a branding meeting this morning. And it was like, ART, creates enduring change. I'm like, I don't know that we can claim that. I was like, I'm not interested in claiming that theater's gonna like change someone. And frankly, what does enduring change mean? Because maybe we continue to change. But we can be a place for inquiry, like genuine inquiry and listening. And I do believe listening, like you all are here, we're all here together. It's a muscle. Like you actually have to practice it. And you have to practice it, and what's great about the theater listening is it's with your heart. It's not just, with your mind and your opinions and in sound bites, but you actually have to think with your heart. And sometimes you can't even have the thought, you're just feeling a little bit. But that's important too, so I don't even know I got off your
question. No, it's fine. No, it's great. I love these reflections. I have one more question. We're going to open it up for, so that's a heads up to all of you. We're going to take a couple of questions from folks in the audience. But I have a big question, and it gets at some of the things that you already talked about. It gets at this idea of how theater was, everything was disrupted and also challenged, not just by the pandemic, but by the racial reckoning following the torture and murder of George Floyd in the summer of 2020, which of course were happening simultaneously while you're trying to keep this community and cast together in 1776, right? So many questions about representation and about who's on stage, what stories get told, what stories don't get told, who gets to tell them, right? These are big questions that aren't just about theater, they're also about democracy, they're about our public health, they're about our the world that we either do or don't decide to live in together.
Yeah.
And you have, you're a good kind of evangelist for the theater because you talk about it in these big ways, right? Expanding the boundaries of theater, right? You've talked about theater as a town hall, right? It's having a role to play. And I'm wondering, now that we're in this new place, right? Not exactly post-pandemic, but we've gone through these challenges and changes, some of them unprecedented. What do you see here moving forward as the role of the theater in our very, very divided democracy and world?
It's a big one. I think the theater is necessary to who we are as humans. I really believe that because it's about being together in physical space. And I think the pandemic really made that very apparent, that what we missed and also how we function without being physically together. And there are a lot of things that can happen. And there's a lot of amazing technology. I'm very happy that not every design meeting are designers from all over the world hopping on planes and coming to Boston for a meeting. Like, let's not do that to the environment. So there are lots of things that are that we learn from the pandemic. But I think the role of theater to create space where you actually come to spend a few hours not on yourself, but to identify and open yourself to someone else's story. You know, without knowing where it's going to take you. Right? Someone asked me in an interview the other day, like, you know, audiences get worried that, like, they're going to be uncomfortable at a theater event. Like, that was for audience participation. Like, what do you think about, should theater make, you know, is part of the role of theater to be uncomfortable? I was like, well, let's not do that, because, you know, we want audiences to come to the theater. But I do think I do believe as humans, we need to be challenged. There's a human need to learn. There's a human need for spectacle, to see, what a spectacle, to see something greater than ourselves. It's like why we like to go on a mountaintop and look at a mountain or look at a horizon. That's spectacle. It's awe, right? These are human needs. We have a human need for ritual, to move through an event in a group, right? While we do things that are rituals. Like we like to go, you know, to a church, say, and go, and we go through, and we sit, and we do things, and we sing together. It's moving through an event as a group. So, and we have a human need for entertainment, right? Like the French word is, divertissement. You know, to be diverted, because we actually need a little diversion in our life, because we're faced with so many things. So it's actually a human need to be diverted. So I believe that the theater provides these things in only the way the theater can, because it is about the physical embodiment. And I think as we face amazing technological revolution that we're in, face it, that's where we are. It's the digital revolution, AI, it's here. As we go into all of that, which we're not going to be able to stop, it's like, how do we continue to investigate what it means to be human? And the theater is a unique gymnasium for that. So I think we have to cherish our theaters. We have to build our theaters, which we're building a new theater for this very purpose on the Harvard campus, the Center for Creativity and Performance. It's going to arrive in 2 years. How do we create spaces? We have to support theaters. We have to expose our young people to theater so they'll come to the theater. We've got to increase our audience. We've got to bring theater to people. It can't be like a nice to have. It's a must have. It's like a must have fundamentally to who we are. So I think, you know, I'm grateful to all of you who, you know, I feel like you're here because maybe you're some of the people out there who know that somewhere in your core. But we have to flex that muscle as theater makers and audience partners to like ensure that continues to happen.
Yeah. And the way that theater can delight and surprise, I mean, we were at opening night of Real Women Have Curves recently, and what I came right up to afterwards, it was the middle of December, it had been a tough run on the campus and in the world. And I had tears in my eyes the next day. I didn't know how much I needed that.
Yeah.
Right? That was a gift, right, that we all were able to share in. That those performers and the entire, you know, musical ensemble, that community created, gave us a blessing that night.
And you know, also, I just want to say this, because you said that I thought, I mean, yes, it's the story, but when I was young and I used to go to see shows on Broadway, I would always cry at the curtain call.
Always.
So why are we crying at the curtain? I don't know. Does anybody cry at curtain calls? I cry. I get emotional at curtain calls. And I think it's because when I heard you say all those performers, it's because you are actually witnessing in the theater a group of people doing something.
That's right. Together.
Together. So yes, it's a story and it's a narrative and it's great playwriting and so. But like, look at what we heard. We heard a bunch of people singing in harmony. It's undeniable. You are doing something together. It's like a model. It's a model for like what we have to do in this world, is work together. So there's something on a very simple level of theater that makes us like gives us the, you know, the faith again. Even if it's, you know, we're not changing the world, we're at least coming together and doing something together.
Mm-hmm.
And working hard and stretching ourselves and bringing, you know, creating something for an audience.
Yeah.
So, speaking of audience, I want to start with the performers, the artist students. If one of you has a question first for Diane Paulus. Yeah, go ahead.
That was the question was, yeah. I've been really inspired by theater, but the question was, what made me inspired to be a director and not go into acting? So it's an excellent question. I really loved acting, and I think like a lot of young people, I thought like my dream would be to be a successful actor. But I do remember I went to acting school for 2 years in New York City after college, and we were all sitting around late at night, talking at one of those like late night moments, and we were all going around. We were about to graduate from this acting school, and everyone was like, what do you want? It's your dream. And everybody went around and said, oh, I want to go to Hollywood. I want to be in the movies. I want to get a soap opera. And trust me, I was like trying to get an agent. I was auditioning for soap operas. I was doing all of that, not getting any work, but I was trying. But I remember at this moment saying to all my acting friends, oh, you know what? I wanna, you know, go be Robert Brustein and run the American Repertory Theater in Cambridge. I kid you not, I said this. This I was like, you know, so wait, I was like out of Harvard, so you know, I was 21, did this, I was 23, right? So 20 years later, I got this job. But back then, so you notice these things about yourself. I said that, then I still went on and got an agent and did a lot of acting work. But you notice, right? You notice what you say, and that kind of stays with you. Then I also met this woman who works here in Boston at a donor event. She was my camp counselor at Interlochen. I don't know if you know Interlochen. Wonderful camp in Michigan where I went to study piano. And she came up to me. She was like, it was like Helen. She was like, do you remember me? I was your camp counselor. I was like, really? Like I was 8 years old, 8 or 9 years old at Interlochen. And she said to me, you know what you said to me when you were 8? I'm going to be a director. I was like, I did? I had no memory of it. She was like, don't you remember you were directing all the kids in the cabin? You were like making those plays. I was like, oh yeah, I guess I did that. You know. So these things keep happening in your life. But I'll tell you the truth. This is me. I know how hard it is to be an actor. And at some point I was like, you know what? I like to work hard. I like to stay up all night, you know. I don't want to have to get on stage and perform. I was like, I'd rather have stayed up all night. Actors, they have to like take care of their bodies. They have to take care of their voice. They have to go on and perform. I'm like, I'd rather pull the all-nighter, have drunk a lot of coffee, and then I can sit in the back and watch. Like, I don't have to get on stage. And you know, when you're an actor, you're and now I know I'm older now, and I've learned like, you know, your body and your health, like even a director has to take care of that. So you know, I'm very, you know, I'm paying attention to my body in a different way now, which is a good thing. But you know, actors have to you performing, and I just realized I didn't have that performance bug. Like you have to really want to be a performer because it's hard. You know, you get rejected, and we have to wait. And I was too impatient. I wanted to make things, and I didn't want to have to wait. I wanted to create things on my own. I think you've heard me talk enough that I had like this entrepreneurial energy. I wanted to make things. I wanted to make shows. So I didn't have the patience. I didn't have the stamina to be an actor. And I knew I could channel everything more fully as a director.
Mm. Yeah, over here.
Hi, my name is Abby, and my question is, since you were so hard...
Since you work so hard as a director, and like a show comes out, and everybody gets to see it, everyone has their opinions, how do you deal with people that don't like it, like the backlash and things like that? Since you work so hard, and you're just like, oh my gosh, I did all of this and people don't like it. How do you mentally and physically deal with that?
The critics question.
Yeah, the critics. Yeah. You know what? I think one thing you have, you know, you learn as you get older and the more public you become, like not everyone is gonna like you. Like, you just kind of learn that. Like, and you can't let that, you know, and it, so what you have to do is you have to continue to go deep into why you're doing what you're doing. Right, and it can, and the reason why someone might not like something has nothing to do with you, actually. So you can really get in your head, and it can be destructive, right? So you have to identify why you do what you do. You really have to. You have to. You have to really understand why you're doing what you're doing,
And frankly, if you're going to work as hard as, you know, I like to work, you have to do it for a deep reason. Right? So, and they're all, I think they're phases in life that you go through. I always say to young people, it's so liberating when you finally get to that moment as a young theater person and, you know, your parents aren't in the audience. You know what I mean? Like, because there's so much growing up that's natural. You're doing it like for your community, your parents are there. And it's like, then when you become a professional, it has nothing to do with your parents anymore. You know, that's a big learning curve moment, you know? And it's like, it doesn't matter what my parents think. And you know, my parents are there. It's a much bigger journey I'm on. And so you have to identify why you do what you do. And you have to know that... I tend to be very brutal and I like to hear everything because I like to hear it. And there's some things you just have to like turn off and turn away, but I find it can be a catalyst. You know, and even if I hear something, I'm like, well, I don't agree with that. Or like, they did that, they're criticizing something that's not even in the show. Or frankly, like when I was very publicly attacked by Stephen Sondheim on The Grocer's Boy, he never even saw the show. Like literally, and he was a very famous person writing very publicly about what we were doing to the Gershwin's Poor EMS. You know, and I just had to know, like he had never seen it. But he can have his opinion, you know, and frankly, you know what it did? When people came to the air to see that, there was like, people were there, like, I'm gonna see what she's doing. And there was like an energy in that audience, like, I'm here to see for myself. And you see, you have to like learn to embrace, it's hard.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna lie to you, it's hard. And you have very good friends that become your inner court that help you get through tough times. But I think you pick yourself up because you're in it for a bigger reason. And the great thing about a career in the arts is every downhill you have is like gives you life experience. Gives you a well of deeper understanding of like psychology and emotion, and it like you feed it into your next show. You know, so that's it's like again, I think why would I not be in this business? Like every hard hit you get, it's like it's not for naught. It's like it's fuel. It's fuel. It's like education. It's emotional intelligence that I can now impart to an actor. It's deeper understanding of a tough time that I can now relate to and channel it. I mean, Gloria Steinem used to say, who I worked with, you know, the last moment of going through healing trauma is when you can help someone else from your trauma, your lived trauma. And that's like the healing is when you can use your trauma to help someone else. So, you know, being an artist is that writ large. You know, whether it's your personal things you've gone through or friends or family or what you witness in the world, you can just keep finding a way to feed it into, you know, something creative.
Another thing that helps you navigate the criticism of someone like Sondheim about what you're doing with Porgy and Bess is you cast Audrey McDonald.
Yes. Yes.
Just let her
sing.
Right. Yeah. Do her thing. Anyway, one more question, and then we're going to wrap it up. Yeah. Right here.
Oh, and then we'll go to you.
Yeah, we'll
do
these. We'll do these
one
two.
And two.
Yeah,
yes.
We'll do these two.
You've directed a lot of revivals. I was wondering, are there any shows that you'd love to direct in the future?
That is such a good question. And you know, I literally have sat through, you know, I Google like 100 best musicals and I look at them and I'm like, oh, do I want to do Grease? No, I don't think so. Like I like go through them. I have a lot of new musicals in development right now. So my kind of like my headspace is filled with all these new shows I'm working on, which take a lot. I am looking at some classic work that I'm thinking about doing, which I can't speak about tonight because it's not official yet, but there might be one coming next season, which is very different for me, that I've always wanted to direct, a classic play. And
Yeah, you know, and some new shows that are out there in the universe, like some subject matter that I've always wanted to touch, or some, you know, things that are, you know, some movies that have been done. So there are all kinds of different material out there that interests me. But I'm always also looking for an idea. So if anybody here is like, I would love to see this show again, you know, toss it my way. I'm always like interested in what people want to see again, or like a show that has meaning for people. So, yeah.
Right. Here.
When we communicate, we are nurturing different perspectives about what we want to say, because every topic has a multitude of different perspectives relative to whether we're focusing on how people think, how people dress, how people put together their thoughts. And the thing that I'm fascinated with is how this is all about feeding our cognitive skills. Because we can just continue to grow by simply thinking about things in as many different perspectives as we can consider. Mm. And to me, that's a fascination, because it's something we can all do, and a lot of us may not have even realized that we have that capacity.
Yes, yes, I love that. That's the gymnasium of the theater. You know, and maybe the last thing I'll say, a really passionate project I'm working on now is working with medical school students at Harvard Medical School on theater techniques.
You're going to find this very interesting, because I am supposed to be presenting on a video form for Tufts Dental School. It is for patients who will be coming there and addressing their anxiety regarding having their teeth get the dental needs that they prefer. And it's very interesting. I did write it quickly, but I like to cover all the different bases that can be created in anybody's thoughts and questions and fears, because it all depends on how we view those things, that we can see how we can resolve the anxiety that comes along with it.
I
wanted to wrap by giving you one opportunity to talk a little bit about the stuff that you're currently developing.
Yes.
You have a show that you're literally in rehearsal today. You came right from rehearsal here. And then there's a big musical in the spring. And
I can't leave without plugging what we're doing at ART. So yeah. I am in rehearsal for a world premiere of a new play. And it is called Becoming a Man, written by P. Carl. And P. Carl wrote a memoir, which you could get. It's a beautiful memoir, incredibly beautifully written, critically acclaimed, came out before the pandemic. It's also called Becoming a Man. And it tells the story of Carl's journey, having been born a woman, transitioning to being a man in his 50s. And he had a 20-year relationship with his wife, and what it meant for him to discover himself more truly, who he is, while his wife was losing what she thought was her wife, right? So it's really a play about marriage and relationships and love and this thing we've talked about of continual growth and change in our lives. And when we open ourselves to that journey, can the loved ones in our lives come with us? So it's a beautiful play. We're going to premiere it February 15th is the first preview. And we do something called Act Two, which is after every single performance, there's a town hall conversation with different guests who come. And we just announced in a press release, so if you Google it, you go home tonight, you'll see that we have a whole roster of people from all across Boston who are coming to be guests in the conversation afterwards, to be kind of catalysts for conversation with the audience around these topics, gender, health. And so that's the play. And then coming at the end of the season is a world premiere musical of The Great Gatsby. And it's called Gatsby. And the music is written by Florence and the Machine.
Yes.
So I was just with her 2 days ago in New York. We just did a big run through. So incredible original score written by Florence Welch and Thomas Bartlett, her writing partner.
And Rachel Chavkin is directing it, who directed The Great Comet and Hayestown, if people know that musical, she won the Tony for. And Martina Mayak, who won the Pulitzer Prize for her work, is the book writer. So it's an incredible adaptation of, obviously, this great American novel, and that will be a world premiere starting in May.
Great. Diane, you never cease to dazzle and amaze me and inspire, and it is wonderful to be your friend, and it is so wonderful to have you here at Thayer and sharing with this community. Thank you again to all of the amazing student artists who surprised Diane tonight. Yeah. And thanks, Thayer, for the Global Speaker Series and for having us. And wonderful, all of you took time out of your night to gather and be here. And thanks for coming.
See you
get
at the
home
theater.
Safely.
See you at the
Take
theater.
Care.